السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته dear colleagues and friends. Welcome back to our sessions for the part 3 MRCOG exam candidates. Today we are going to start the first session for candidates who are going for May exam. Very important topic today. Why it's very important? First, because we are facing this scenario in our clinical practice and it's very important for all of us to know how to manage and how to diagnose such a situation. Second part is for the exam. This task has appeared in last February and in last November exam. It appears in so many forms, but the management, the diagnosis, and how to proceed through the task was the same. Peripartum cardiomyopathy, there is a new talk that will make your life easier. And we will go through a quick review about this talk today. So, what's peripartum cardiomyopathy? We will give a quick review about this talk because it may appear as a structured discussion. Then we will come to the scenario that appeared as a simulated patient task. So, let's start by the definition of peripartum cardiomyopathy. It means enlargement of the heart ventricles, mainly on the left side, causing left ventricular systolic dysfunction. The diagnostic criteria include it appears towards the end of pregnancy and up to 6 months postpartum. This is the main timing that will differentiate peripartum cardiomyopathy from idiopathic cardiomyopathy. Peripartum cardiomyopathy accounts for 1/3 of the causes of the maternal cardiac death. The incidence is uncommon. It occurs in less than 1 in 1,000 pregnancies. The etiology, mostly unknown. There is no clear etiology for peripartum cardiomyopathy, but there are multifactorial factors. These multifactorial factors include the genetic predisposition and the vascular hormonal insult. This vascular hormonal insult leads to increase in the level of prolactin. That's why bromocriptine will be one of the management options, and also increase in the vascular endothelial growth factor, which leads to endothelial dysfunction and dilatation of the heart ventricles. What are the risk factors? Peripartum cardiomyopathy appears more in women from the Afro-Caribbean ethnicity, in multiparity, in multiple pregnancy, in obese women, in chronic hypertension, in preeclampsia, and in advanced maternal age, which is more than 30 years. How to diagnose? As we mentioned before, the diagnosis or the duration or the timing will be around the end of pregnancy and up to 6 months postpartum. The diagnosis here is a diagnosis of exclusion. So, mandatory criteria occurs towards the end of pregnancy and up to 6 months postpartum. It is associated with dilatation of the left ventricle and the ejection fraction is less than 45%. These are diagnostic criteria after exclusion of all other possible causes. Regarding the symptoms, it is the same symptoms of heart failure, but there is a problem here in the diagnosis, and the patient will ask you in the simulated patient task, why my condition was not diagnosed earlier? So your answer, because most of the symptoms of heart failure, they are the same as the symptoms towards the end of pregnancy. So most of the women towards the end of pregnancy will have dyspnea, will have orthopnea, they will have edema, they will have palpitation, they will have fatigue, abdominal discomfort. So that's why the diagnosis will be difficult because most of the symptoms of heart failure are almost the same like the symptoms towards the end of pregnancy, except for the unexplained cough or the chest pain. When you have a case of suspected peripartum cardiomyopathy, you have to do initial evaluation. And as we mentioned before, for diagnosis of any case or for evaluation of any case, you have to be organized and systematic. How? Not to miss any point, go through step by step. So first, the history. What you need to ask about the history here? You need to ask about any history of congenital or acquired heart disease and the family history of similar conditions in the heart. The examination, you will go through the examination steps, general, abdominal, and cardiac examination. The investigation here, we will do ECG and echocardiography and blood test. The ECG here has no specific pattern. If you find any specific pattern, this will direct you toward any other cardiac cause like ischemic or thromboembolic disease. So in the ECG, there is no specific pattern. The echo is crucial for the diagnosis of peripartum cardiomyopathy. We mentioned before the timing around the end of pregnancy with ejection fraction less than 45% is after exclusion of other causes. This will be mainly how to diagnose peripartum cardiomyopathy. So the echo is crucial. If the ejection fraction is less than 45%, this is a diagnostic criteria for the peripartum cardiomyopathy. Regarding the blood test here, we will do the usual blood test to exclude anemia, one of the causes of dizziness and one of the causes of dyspnea and one of the causes of palpitation towards the end of pregnancy. We'll do infection screen. We can do troponin, but the most important here is the natriuretic peptide, which will be increased in cases of peripartum cardiomyopathy. So, quick review now. We know what is the definition of peripartum cardiomyopathy, what is the timing that peripartum cardiomyopathy occurs around it, and the incidence of peripartum cardiomyopathy less than 1 in 1,000 pregnancies. The etiology unknown, but there are multifactorial factors. Remember the genetic predisposition and the vascular hormonal insult. Which women are at increased risk of peripartum cardiomyopathy and how to diagnose? Diagnosis of exclusion with dilated left ventricle and ejection fraction less than 45%. So, usually the scenario that will come in the exam will be a lady which is having shortness of breath towards the end of pregnancy or the postpartum period. How you are going to manage such lady? You will do natriuretic peptide and echocardiography. If you find that the atrial natriuretic peptide are increased and the ejection fraction is less than 45%, this means you have to involve the cardiologist and consider peripartum cardiomyopathy or other cardiovascular differential diagnosis. After exclusion of other cardiovascular causes, you will consider peripartum cardiomyopathy if you find that the natriuretic peptides are increased and the ejection fraction is less than 45%. The natriuretic peptides are normal and the ejection fraction is more than 45%, so peripartum cardiomyopathy is unlikely in this case, so you will consider non-cardiovascular causes. This is a flow chart how to go through a case which is presenting with shortness of breath towards the end of pregnancy and in the postpartum period. We mentioned so many times that the diagnosis is diagnosis of exclusion, so you have to exclude other causes of shortness of breath towards the end of pregnancy or the other causes that you have to exclude before diagnosing the peripartum cardiomyopathy. What are the other causes? Benign dyspnea of pregnancy. That's why the diagnosis is difficult because most of the cases will have the same symptoms toward the end of pregnancy. You have to exclude any heart arrhythmia, amniotic fluid embolism, bronchial asthma, pre-existing idiopathic dilated cardiomyopathy. You have to exclude HIV cardiomyopathy. If there is any valvular heart disease, if there is any hypertensive heart disease, if there is any cardiac dysfunction or pulmonary embolism. So these are the differential diagnosis. You have to exclude all these causes before considering peripartum cardiomyopathy. How you diagnose? You will find specific symptoms from the history by the examination, specific criteria, and by the investigation, you will find a specific criteria on the ECG and the ejection fraction will be more than 45 in most of the other causes, and the presentation will be different. So you have to exclude all other causes before considering peripartum cardiomyopathy. Okay, now you have a case of peripartum cardiomyopathy or any case of shortness of breath or heart failure towards the end of pregnancy. What you need to do? You need to confirm the diagnosis. How to confirm the diagnosis? As we mentioned, you have to do an ECG. You have to do a blood test, mainly natriuretic peptide, chest X-ray, and echo. What you will find is specific here for peripartum cardiomyopathy in ECG, no specific pattern. In the blood test, the natriuretic peptides will be increased. The chest X-ray, you may find dilated or cardiomegaly. In the echo, you will find that the left ventricular ejection fraction is less than 45%. In this case, if you confirm the diagnosis of peripartum cardiomyopathy, how is your management? The management will be you have to start antenatal corticosteroids for fetal lung maturity. You have to consider multidisciplinary team management. The multidisciplinary team here will involve the obstetrician, the cardiologist, the neonatologist, and definitely the anesthetist in any multidisciplinary team and the intensivist, because the management of this case will be mainly in the HDU. Now, you have to assess the severity of heart failure. The severity of heart failure will depend on the blood pressure, the heart rate, the respiratory rate, and the saturation. So if you have severe acute heart failure or cardiogenic shock, you will evaluate the patient if she's antepartum or postpartum. The management will be a little bit different. So if the patient is antepartum, again, the multidisciplinary team will be involved. The timing of delivery will depend on the condition of the mother, but you have to balance between the maternal condition and the risk of prematurity in the baby. If the maternal condition is deteriorating, so you will recommend the delivery again after considering antenatal corticosteroids. All these points will be considered in your evaluation in the exam. So recommend the delivery after giving antenatal corticosteroids and advanced acute heart failure therapy. If the maternal condition is stable, so you will give the heart failure therapy. The heart failure therapy here will be hydralazine, nitrates, beta blockers, and you may consider diuretics. All these are safe during a pregnancy. Once the maternal condition is stable, you will plan the delivery after multidisciplinary team meeting. Vaginal delivery is the rule. Vaginal delivery is the rule here. So if the condition appeared in the postpartum period, in this case, you need to consider heart failure therapy again. But the heart failure therapy here will be different in the postpartum period than in the antepartum period, because here you can give the drugs which are considered teratogenic if you are giving it during pregnancy. So ACE inhibitors and mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists, these are contraindicated in the antepartum period, but it can be given here, and also beta blockers and diuretics can be given also in the postpartum period. And here you will consider bromocriptine. Remember, during the etiology, we mentioned there is hormonal vascular insult associated with increased prolactin level, so you will consider bromocriptine. After this, you will evaluate the condition of the lady and according the condition, if according to her recovery. If she recovered well, you may wean here. If she was on mechanical circulatory support, if the recovery is not good, you may consider heart transplantation. So this is a flow chart, how to go through the management of a case of acute heart failure or shortness of breath at the end of pregnancy and in the postpartum period. You have to confirm the diagnosis. If you confirm the diagnosis of peripartum cardiomyopathy, give antenatal corticosteroids, multidisciplinary team, and then according to the severity and according to the maternal condition, you will decide either to give heart failure therapy and continue pregnancy up to 37 weeks and delivery will be by vaginal route, or you may consider immediate delivery after giving corticosteroids if the maternal condition is deteriorating. So what are the important points that has to be mentioned here? These are the points that will be borderline or fail in this task. So multidisciplinary team approach is mandatory to be mentioned in this task. If you didn't mention the multidisciplinary team, you will have a borderline in the communication. Avoidance of heart failure drugs and teratogenic risk. In this case, you cannot give ACE inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blockers or mineralocorticoid receptor antagonists for a pregnant lady. These drugs can be given postpartum, but cannot be given during pregnancy. So this is a very important point also in the clinical knowledge and in the safety. Consideration of bromocriptine, we mentioned because of the pathophysiology, bromocriptine will be considered for the management in the postpartum period. Anticoagulation is very important during pregnancy and postpartum for at least 6 weeks after delivery, and it may be considered longer. And for the next pregnancy, this lady, if she's willing to have another pregnancy after counseling her of the risk, this lady has to start antepartum, antenatal anticoagulation, and then postpartum anticoagulation. In case of cardiogenic shock, if you are going to give inotropic drug, the first line here will be levosimendan. The levosimendan is the first line inotropic drug instead of catecholamine in normal cases. Definitely, these cases has to be transferred to HDO for management because she may need mechanical circulatory support. So these points, this table is very important because all the points mentioned here has to be mentioned during the task, either structured discussion or simulated patient task. This point has to be mentioned because all these points are borderline and failure points during the evaluation. So what is the prognosis of prepartum cardiomyopathy? Usually the recovery in cases of prepartum cardiomyopathy is good. 50 to 80% of the cases will recover. But the recovery or the prognosis will be poor if the left ventricular size is more than 6 cm and if the ejection fraction is less than 30%. So these are the criteria of poor prognosis. And in this case, the mortality rate will be around 10%. So we mentioned the ejection fraction so many times. So how to correlate the ejection fraction to the condition of the lady or to the pregnant or to the postpartum lady? So the ejection fraction is less than 45%. This is criteria for diagnosis of peripartum cardiomyopathy. We mentioned after it is a diagnosis of exclusion, but there will be left ventricular dilatation. The ejection fraction will be less than 45%, and it occurs around the end of pregnancy and in the first 6 months after delivery. So less than 45% ejection fraction, it is diagnostic of peripartum cardiomyopathy. Less than 35%, in this case, this lady, you have to offer her anticoagulation. Less than 24, consider, but less than 35%, this lady will need anticoagulation and it will be a failure point if you didn't mention it in the exam. Less than 30% ejection fraction means the prognosis here is poor and this lady may need mechanical support or she may even need heart transplant later. If the ejection fraction is less than 25%, this is an absolute contraindication for pregnancy. Definitely, pregnancy is not recommended anymore, whatever the ejection fraction, but the risk will be here higher if the ejection fraction is less than 25%. So this is an absolute contraindication. The prognosis in the next pregnancy, this will be a question that will be asked by the role player and you may be asked if it is a structured discussion. So the prognosis, if there is complete recovery, the prognosis will be better and 20% of women may have further relapse if they come pregnant again. So this is in case of complete recovery. But if there is persistent left ventricular dysfunction, there is 50% chance of further deterioration and the morbidity here will increase up to 20%. The morbidity and mortality rates will be as high as 20%. The left ejection fraction is less than 25%. As we mentioned before, this is a contraindication for pregnancy. What is the other contraindication of pregnancy? If the left ventricular ejection fraction has not normalized after the course of treatment and adequate medical care. So this is the prognosis. In case of complete recovery, and if there is persistent left ventricular dysfunction, and if there is severe deterioration in the condition, which are contraindications or absolute contraindications of pregnancy. Now, management in the next pregnancy. This is a question you will be asked in the simulated patient task and in the structured discussion, and you should have a clear points in your answer. What are the points? Your care will be under multidisciplinary team. You will need antenatal anticoagulation or blood thinner if you are speaking to the patient. Non-teratogenic medications, you will mention the drugs which are safe in pregnancy. This lady will need serial growth scan starting from 26 weeks because she's at high risk of fetal growth restriction. The delivery will be at 37 weeks if the maternal condition is stable in a consultant-led unit under continuous maternal and fetal monitoring. And the vaginal birth same unless there is any other obstetric contraindication for vaginal delivery or there is any deterioration in the maternal condition. What is the management during labor? Shortening of the second stage of labor to avoid overstraining on the heart. The management of the third stage of labor, and definitely you will avoid ergometrine, and the anticoagulation will be continued for at least 6 weeks postpartum and then re-evaluation. And this lady will be advised against pregnancy and she has to be offered effective contraception, which is LARC, long-acting reversible contraception. So this will be the management in the next pregnancy. And definitely before the next pregnancy, if she's willing, She has to do echo, and the echo has a schedule for women with peripartum cardiomyopathy if she's planning for next pregnancy. So you will do echo preconception to see what is the ejection fraction, and according to the ejection fraction, you may advise her not to get pregnant again because ejection fraction is less than 25%, and this is absolute contraindication for pregnancy. You need to repeat the echo at the end of the first trimester, the end of the second trimester, 1 month before delivery, after delivery, and 1 month after delivery again. So this is the peripartum cardiomyopathy. Quick review about all the points that can be mentioned. This is a quick review about all the information that appeared in the TOG article. So this case or this task appeared in the exam in two scenarios, in February and in November. It appeared as you are an ST5 once you are in the ward, and once it came while you are in the postnatal clinic, 6 weeks postpartum. But I chose this one because here you will start counseling the patient, you will start the management from the very early, not only from 6 weeks postpartum. So here in this task, it is a simulated patient task. You will be assessed in the information gathering, the patient safety, the communication with the patient and families, and in the applied clinical knowledge. Here you are an ST5. You are in the ward. So the patient after delivery, within the first few days after delivery. And the midwife was unhappy with the discharge note prepared by your junior doctor. The patient is about to go home, and the midwife asked you to review the patient and ensure that the discharge arrangements are appropriate. The case notes are not immediately available. And when you find this point, this is a point of situation awareness that you need to take a history from the patient and will be considered as a point of information gathering. So obtain relevant history, and relevant means relevant. Please don't go through full details, because this is a point most of the candidates, they are taking, I can say, haphazard or non-targeted history, which will affect their mark in the information gathering and in the communication. Then you have to explain to the patient what's peripartum cardiomyopathy. That's why the introduction was important. And you will give her the management plan and advise her on the prognosis and subsequent management in the next pregnancy. These are the discharge notes written by the junior colleague. He just mentioned that the patient was 34 years old, developed preeclampsia. This is one risk factor. 34 is another risk factor. After delivery, she became dyspneic and unwell. The diagnosis was unclear initially, but the cardiologist diagnosed the case as a cardiomyopathy, and she was in the intensive care for 4 days, and she is now better. This is a deficient discharge letter written by the junior colleague. So your agenda here, you have to obtain a relevant history, explain to the patient, and mention the other points which are not written here in the discharge note. For those who are going to the exam for the first time, I just give this frame or this slide just to let you know how the simulated patients are instructed to act in the exam. So they will get, the simulated patient will be a non-medical personnel. So please deal with the simulated patient as if she's a real patient. She has no medical knowledge. So you have to take care of your way of communication. She will not understand the jargons. She will not understand the medical term. She's giving instruction, and the instructions, she will answer your questions. And if you didn't ask her, or if you didn't cover the important points in the task, the role player will ask you. For example, if you didn't mention what is the cardiomyopathy, she will ask you, what's wrong with my heart? What has caused it? If you didn't mention that the etiology is unknown, why this was not picked earlier? You will, if you didn't mention that the symptoms are the same as the symptoms at the end of pregnancy, she will ask you, how do I know that I will be safe at home? So you have to give her discharge notes and red flag signs. And what will happen next? You will advise her regarding the management regarding what's going to happen in the next weeks and what's going to happen in the next pregnancy. The task which appeared in the exam, the patient had an IVF and she has frozen embryos. So she will ask you, can I get pregnant again? And what I'm going to do with my embryos? So very important to give the patient a chance to ask in the exam. Please, simulated patient is a discussion. You have to act regarding the patient agenda, not your own agenda. So every now and then, stop and ask the patient, do you have any other questions? The patient will ask you, the questions will give you a mark. Don't think that the patient is making your life hard. No, she's guiding you where you are going to take the mark. So please give the patient a chance to ask during the discussion. Also, for those who are going for the exam for the first time, these are the clinical examiner instructions. So the clinical examiner will be given instructions regarding the points of your evaluation. Here, he will be evaluated regarding four domains. The information gathering, so he will be given the points that you need to ask in the history. The communication with the patient, how you are dealing with the patient in a sympathetic way, how to inspire her confidence after what happened to her and she was in HDU for 4 days. Also in the clinical knowledge, you have to explain to the patient what is the condition, what are the reasons, what is the incidence. And in the patient safety, what are the points that has to be mentioned here? So how to go through the task, how to perform during the 10 minutes. Introduce yourself and create a rapport. What is the aim of the consultation here? You will tell the patient that the midwife called me to speak to you because they are preparing for your discharge. And your discharge letter to the GP was written by one of my junior colleagues. It's a good letter. It is a good letter, but it is a little bit short. And I need to add some more information about what actually happened to you, as it looks that you didn't have a great time after your delivery. It's a nice way of speaking to the patient, nice way of explaining the aim of the consultation or the aim of the discussion without undermining your colleagues. It is a little bit short. So, and I need to add some more information. So avoid undermining your colleague here by mentioning unnecessary phrases. And then ask the patient about this patient already postpartum, 4 or 5 days postpartum. So as usual in the patient postpartum, you have to ask about the 6 Bs. What are the 6 Bs? The baby, this patient has been, then breastfeeding, then the bowel and the bladder. How's your bowel and water work? You have to ask about the pain and the bleeding. So these are the 6 Bs. Pain and bleeding, bowel and bladder, baby and breast. So these are the 6 Bs postpartum. Then ask the patient about her concerns or expectation. This lady was not happy of what happened. So she will exactly tell you, I need to know what happened to me. 2 days ago, I have been transferred back from the ICU to the maternity ward, but the midwife seemed to be busy looking after other mothers with new babies that I'm still not sure what happened to me. And now they have said that I'm going home. So this lady was not debriefed about what happened to her. She's not happy with the way they dealt with her in the previous 2 days after she has been transferred back from the ICU to the ward. So she needs full explanation. She needs reassurance and she needs sympathy. So now your agenda. Again, for those who are going for the exam or those who didn't see any previous discussions, agenda is mandatory. So what you are going to do here, I'm here today to provide you with all the information you need to understand what happened and how your follow-up will be. In order to do this, I need to ask you some questions. I will discuss your treatment plan. I will add some information to your discharge letter. And I will involve my consultant and the heart specialist, means as a cardiologist, in later, and I will provide you with a patient information leaflet about your case. So this is your agenda and the way how you are going to deal with this case. If you run out of time, the examiner will know that you are a competent candidate. He will write at the end of the evaluation sheet that this candidate was a competent candidate, but he ran out of time. But he knows that what you are going to do in this task if you have enough time. So the targeted history here, don't go again in irrelevant and untargeted history. What you need to ask, can you tell me more about your delivery? This is an open question, so the role player will give you enough information. Please always start with an open question. So he will tell you, I had delivered 6 days ago, 34 weeks, because I had high blood pressure and swollen legs. The doctors and the midwife were worried about my protein in urine and said I have a condition called preeclampsia. They started my labor off and I had births of twins. So a lot of information given because you asked an open question. So how was your pregnancy? Again, another open question. Was there any problems? She will give you a lot of information. Always, always start or take the attitude of open question. This was my first pregnancy, which was an IVF pregnancy due to unexplained infertility. I had 2 embryos transferred and the remaining embryos were frozen and stored. Luckily, I got twin pregnancy, which ran normal till I was diagnosed with high blood pressure and started treatment. I was having swollen legs, but they said it is normal with pregnancy. Till my last visit 1 week ago, they were worried because of the protein in my urine, and they said, I have a preeclampsia, and they recommended to induce my labor. Can you tell me what happened after delivery? Again, open question. So how many information will be given by the role player, especially that they are not medical personnel? They have an information given to them for the simulated patient instruction. Just ask them open questions and they will give you all the details. You will be surprised that so many candidates didn't get that the patient had twin pregnancy. So many candidates didn't know that she has frozen embryos and she's planning for another pregnancy. So open questions will make your life easier. So when you ask her what happened about delivery, she will give you the scenario of what happened to her in the previous 5 days. This lady, after delivery, she went home next day. But suddenly, she got very breathless and felt dizzy and really unwell. Here, I have to be sympathetic and say, sorry. I'm so sorry for that. Be sympathetic with the patient. Was there any chest pain or palpitation? Now, you are asking those the questions. Now, you are targeted towards the complaint of the patient. The patient will tell you there was no chest pain, but I felt terribly breathless as I thought I was drowning, which was a really frightening experience. Oh, I'm so sorry for that. So I came back to the hospital where they gave me an injection and oxygen and did a tracing of my heart rate. Heart specialist was called and she rushed to me to the intensive care unit. I was too much dizzy, but someone told me something about my heart being swollen. Now, she's giving you a clue about the diagnosis. The heart is swollen. It was horrible being separated from my babies. Again, oh, I'm so sorry for that. And frightening, particularly when some of the other patients in the coronary care died. So this patient, you have to be sympathetic with her. You have to offer her counselor because she had a very frightening experience. Later, 2 days ago, I was transferred back to the maternity ward. And since that time, I feel much ignored, so apologize. And no one spoke to me till now about my real situation. I'm really stressed and I want to know what happened and what should I do now. Open questions give you a clue about the task. So please avoid the usual routine of the candidates and of other people who are giving you instruction to ask the same points in the history. Please go to targeted and relevant history. Now, any other relevant points in the history, definitely, you have to ask about the medical conditions. If she's currently any other medications, if she has any drug allergy, and if she has any surgery before, if she was in pregnant before, and if she has any family history of heart conditions, this is very important. And the social history, this lady will go home. And you have to ask about the smoking. This lady is a smoker. This is another risk factor. 10 cigarettes daily when pregnant. She occasionally taking alcohol and no recreational drugs. She's supported at home. How was your mood? This is very important question to be asked here. Very important question to be asked here. How was your mood? So this lady was not happy. She was always a confident lady, but after what happened to her, she lost her confidence, how she's confidence in her ability to cope, especially with two new babies. So you will offer her counselor at this point. Now, this is a point of information gathering finished. Now you are coming to the concern of the lady. You have to explain to her what happened to her. So if you didn't mention cardiomyopathy by your own, the lady will ask you, what's wrong with my heart? So how you answer from what we discussed and you explain to me, you have what we call peripartum cardiomyopathy. If I heard about that, you will definitely say no, because she did not understand what happened to her. So now you have to explain the condition in later. It is enlargement of the heart chambers, mainly on the left side. It's linked to the end of pregnancy, and it may occur up to 6 months after delivery and may lead to heart failure. See, this is the definition of peripartum cardiomyopathy late term. What has caused it? Definitely, I don't want you to wait for the patient to ask you all the questions. So you are explaining to the patient what is the definition of peripartum cardiomyopathy, then move to the next, what is the reason? Usually, it is of unknown cause, but it may be linked to inflammation of the heart or autoimmune condition. Usually, it is uncommon, occurring in less than 1 in 1,000 pregnancies. The diagnosis is difficult, as the same symptoms may occur in normal pregnancy, preeclampsia, and anemia, like shortness of breath, feeling unwell, and also it may lead to buildup of fluids in your body and blood clots in the brain and the lungs. Please go through this information and then stop and ask the patient, am I clear so far? Do you have any questions? If you didn't mention any of this information, definitely the role player will ask you one of these questions. But to be the leader of the discussion, go through these details and stop and ask the patient, do you have any questions? Am I clear till that point? She will guide you to the next part. Now, the patient will ask you, if you didn't mention the prognosis, she will ask you, is it serious? How do I know I will be safe at home? So now you have to explain what is the prognosis. The prognosis here likely to be good, as there is obvious improvement in your condition and you look better now, isn't it? The patient, she will answer you, yes, I feel physically well, but I lost my confidence in my ability to cope, and as I was aware that I was near to die in the ICU. Again, I'm so sorry for that. You have to be empathetic with the patient. Okay. What is next? What is the next step in the management? You will need to mention at this point the cardiologist, the heart specialist, the multidisciplinary team. So you will need heart specialist or the cardiologist in later for further investigation. And to repeat the heart scan, we mentioned the heart scan has to be repeated after delivery in your heart function. Blood pressure was high. So this patient, she will be prescribed the medication to control your blood pressure. It's called beta blockers or ACE inhibitors. If you will be prescribed ACE inhibitor, it is better to avoid breastfeeding. Because you are at high risk of having blood clots in your brain, legs, and lungs, blood thinner, which means anticoagulant in their language, will be prescribed for at least 6 weeks after delivery. Your community midwife and GP will be kept informed. So again, communication. Here the patient will stop you and ask, can I get pregnant again? Will this happen again? So you should have an information about if she's candidate for a new pregnancy or the recurrence rate. So you have to explain to the patient. This will be decided by multidisciplinary team after assessment of your heart function by echocardiography. Because if it is less than 25%, pregnancy is absolutely contraindicated. If it is more than 25%, the lady can get pregnant, but you have to counsel her about the high possibility of recurrence and worse prognosis in the next pregnancy. So there is a high possibility that it could happen again and may get worse in the future pregnancy and may lead to long-term complication. So you will advise her not to get pregnant again and to take an effective contraception, and you will refer her to a contraception clinic to avoid unplanned pregnancy. Because of the scenario that appeared in the exam, the patient was twin pregnancy after an IVF cycle, and she has frozen embryo. So another point of clinical knowledge here has to be mentioned. So if you plan to have more children in the future, and because of the prognosis of the condition, you may have an option of adoption where your embryos will be implanted in the womb of another lady called the surrogate mother, which will carry the pregnancy till delivery, so you can have a child that's biologically related to you. Or the other option will be adoption. So to say it in a good way, there are many children who need love and support, so you can choose adoption, and definitely you will be a great mother for them. Do you have any other questions? Am I clear till that point? Here the patient will explain that she was really disappointed. How little she knew about her case when she was in the hospital. This was very frightening, especially that I was away from my babies. Here, a common mistake from the candidates, they will advise her to go to the PALS, Patient Advisory Liaison Service, which is a mistake here. Here, apologize, the duty of candor. So this is a case of postpartum complication. What you need to do is to remember that you have to mention the 7 Ds. What are the 7 Ds? You already debriefed the patient. This is debriefing. Now, duty of candor, I'm so sorry that has happened to you. So this is the duty of candor. The discharge plan and the red flag signs. This has to be mentioned. The patient has to be given a full discharge letter, and she has to be instructed what are the symptoms that she has to come back, and she has to be given contact numbers to call the hospital immediately if she has any symptoms. So debriefing, discharge and red flags, duty of candor, and definitely datics or incident reporting. So these are the points that has to be covered here from the 7 Ds of clinical governance. So please don't tell the patient, please go to the PALS here, because this was a common mistake from the candidate. I'm so sorry. Say, I'm so sorry. That has happened to you. Most of the time we are trying to explain things as we go, but you know that your condition was quite serious. People wanted to deal with everything quite quickly, and they might not be able to communicate it to you as well as possible. That's why I have done that to you now. And here you can mention that we are going to write an incident report. Definitely, the counselor, as we mentioned, this lady needs support. Mrs. Hull, coping with this experience can be emotionally challenging. We are here to help and support you. So I would like to offer you contact details of our trained counselor that will meet you to help you overcoming this situation. Then you have to end the discussion by consultant appointments to write back to the GP or the midwife and give her patient information leaflet. This is how to go through this task. I went through the details at the beginning of the peripartum cardiomyopathy, all the information that you may need if you face the task as a structured discussion task, and how the role player will ask you, and how to go through the discussion step by step. So, again, for the new candidates, know how you will be evaluated. Now, in the information gathering, what are the points that you will be evaluated in this task? You need to ask about the 6 Ps. You need to ask about her mental history, how she's coping after such experience. The circumstances of the diagnosis of cardiomyopathy, the open questions we mentioned before, the patient will give you all the information. Then the details of the presenting complaint, the onset. This patient has absence of chest pain, shortness of breath and palpitation, exclusion of all other heart disease and the risk factors that are in her case. So these are the points that you'll be evaluated in the information gathering or has to be mentioned here in this task. The communication with the patient in the family. So you should be empathetic. He should reassure the patient and inspire her confidence after she lost her confidence how to cope and how she's going to deal after what she suffered. You should lead the discussion. As I told you, don't wait for the patient to ask. Go through the details, go through the explanation. What is the definition? What are the causes? And what is the prognosis? And then stop in between and ask the patient during the 10 minutes, two or three times, do you have any questions? So if you missed the way, she will guide you back to the right track. Simple explanation of the details in a non-frightening way. And we mentioned how to explain the peripartum cardiomyopathy in a lay-term language. Avoid technical terms and jargons. This task was a lay examiner task. So there was a clinical examiner and lay examiner. So it's very important here to avoid the jargons. It's very important here to be empathetic. You will have double the mark in the communication and the information gathering in this task because there was a lay examiner. So it is very important. These two domains are the most important in this task. It's not a matter of clinical knowledge. It's not a matter of clinical knowledge. Believe me, part three is a matter of communication and how to deal with the patient, especially if there is lay examiner, you should know how to deal with the patient. Definitely, patient information leaflet, consultant and the counselor, these points better to be mentioned early in the agenda. So if you run out of time, you will take the marks of these points in the communication. It's a patient safety. Multidisciplinary team, the borderline, if you didn't mention who is included in the multidisciplinary team, you will have a borderline. If you didn't mention that this lady she has to start thromboprophylaxis for at least 6 weeks after delivery, you will fail in the safety. Just one simple mistake will give you fail in the safety, whatever you will mention in the task. Definitely the drug allergy and the how to avoid, what to avoid in the breastfeeding and the allergy follows the point of the evaluation and the patient safety. In the clinical knowledge, how to explain the peripartum cardiomyopathy, explain the unknown etiology, explain the uncommon incidence, the difficult diagnosis and the good prognosis of her case, the risk of recurrence and deterioration in future pregnancy if she's willing, and what are her management options. So now you know all the details of the peripartum cardiomyopathy. If you faced it as a structured discussion, if you faced it as a diagnosed case of peripartum cardiomyopathy immediately after delivery or 6 weeks postpartum, or if the scenario come as a case of shortness of breath after delivery, how to diagnose the condition, how to go through the explanation, through the diagnosis, through the management, and how to cover all the domains. I will put this video in the group, so it will help you how to see the candidates performing in this task, the good candidate and the non-competent candidate. And I will also post the feedback of the clinical examiner, so you will have a full picture and the full scenario about such task and how to deal with the case. I'm so sorry, it was a little bit long today, but I have to explain all the details, especially for the new candidates who need to have a full picture about how part three tasks are going. So thank you so much. I hope it was useful. If you find it useful, please share it with your friends. And remember me as usual, me and my family, in your prayers. Thank you so much again, and good luck in your exams. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.